Holly Naz, we are glad that you are here. Let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, you know, as we gather here today for worship, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to come together as a community and as you as our Father, Lord. We ask that you bless this time together, Lord. Fill our hearts with your love and your grace. In Jesus' name we pray.
Oh, could play one more song if you wanted to. That's okay. We okay with one more song?
Yeah.
I'm not sure I could put Will on the spot like that, though.
Oh, we know 150 of them.
All right, perfect. Welcome to church, everybody, on this fine, lovely, beautiful fall morning. It's a beautiful morning, isn't it? Absolutely. Absolutely. Now just think, it could be 25 degrees, we could have a foot of snow on the ground, and it would still be a beautiful morning. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So, a couple things. We have community night. We have senior soups. Saturday is at Holly Calvary, hosted by Holly Calvary. November 18th is here, and it's hosted by Carpenter's Church, not hosted by us, but hosted by Carpenter's Church, or using our facility. And December 16th is at Holly Naz, hosted by Holly Naz. So Will's going to do some Christmas stuff, and Di's going to decorate for Christmas, and we're going to have a little Christmas party. Good, perfect, excellent. And then we also have other things that were going on that we do to help the community. One is Blessings in the Backpack, right? Deb's doing Blessings in the Backpack at the Dwelling Center. We're doing Blessings in the Backpack here. Blessings in the Backpack does what? Feed school kids, help school kids, those that are in need, right? And in any way, shape, or form that we can help them, we can partner with people that already do it, right? Why try to do something on our own? Partner with those that do something and do it successfully. Take our resources, apply it to that, multiply it. Second thing we have is, who has old shoes? Yeah. So we have a shoe drive fundraiser. This is for Jaden Knoll. She's going back to Honduras in February. What they do is they take old shoes, and they use old shoes and give them to people that need them. So, I mean, how many people actually wear their shoes out completely besides Ed and I? I guess I got a pair of shoes similar to these that are falling apart. I just can't seem to part with them. And I don't think I'm going to give those away because they're literally falling apart. But I have shoes that I never wear. Do they fix shoes? Okay, so you have shoes that are, you think, even if they're too far gone, worst case scenario, they'll throw them away. Yeah, right. So that'll be picked up next week, will be the last week for it. So if you do want to be a part of that, bring your old shoes in next Sunday or sometime before next Sunday, Wednesday night, or whenever else you have the opportunity to be in the building. Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. Who is reading that and praying that? Everyone's hand should go up, right? Okay, at this point, this is probably the sixth week in a row. Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. I want us to know this. I want us to understand this. I want us to pray this for one another. Because I want our love as a church to increase. I want us to know the depths of God's love, which is too fully great to understand, but I want us to start to understand it. I want our roots to grow down deep. So when people do come against us, when people do question our faith, our roots are deep and we know. We have the power to have the right words to say. Now those that are plugged in with the Holy Spirit, guess what? He'll give you the words to say when you need the words to say it. Won't he? Right? So you don't ever have to think, I'm not good enough. Let God speak through you. And if we're not in constant communion with God, speaking to Him, then I wouldn't expect Him to speak through us. That make sense? So talk to God. Read Ephesians 3, 14 through 21 in your spare time, once a day. You have 7 minutes. Take your 7 minutes to read this. Literally, if you read nothing else, read this. Make this a priority. To get it into your spirit and to pick one person throughout the week, maybe two or three or four, and pray for them specifically. Pray this specifically for them. I'm just going to read 16. I pray that from his glorious unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his spirit. I pray that from his glorious unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his spirit. So we started praying for people again. We need to pick on somebody else. We prayed for me. We prayed for Deb. We prayed for Bobby. Who wants inner strength in their spirit? One person right here. Ann, we're going to pray for Ann. Absolutely, right? Is there anything else specific I should pray for you about? Oh, but we could be better, right? Yeah. Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. And Lord, we bring in, we lift her up before you. And Lord, I ask that from your glorious unlimited resources, you will empower her. Lord, that you will empower her with inner strength with your spirit. Lord, I want love overflowing for her. Lord, I want love to overflow it so completely that it oozes out of her pores. Lord, that she literally can't help but love others like you love others. She can't help but give it away because she's got so much of it. Lord, just fill her up completely from the top of her head to the tips of her toes. Lord, just overflowing so much that just blows her away. Lord, touch her in a way that only you can do so. Let her know that she is your precious daughter. Father, we thank you once again for everything. Lord, I ask that you just bless her socks off. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. Take a few moments to give back to the Lord. And, you know, he asks for us to give back to him. He asks that we be joyful when we give back to him. And when we give back to God, it's an act of worship. We're worshiping him, and we're thanking him literally for all that he's giving us. He's blessed us so much more that we can't even begin to understand it. And all he demands is that, not even demands, he says, give back a little bit, just a little bit. A little bit to me, and when you do so, just be thankful. As an act of worship, let's give back to God and say, Lord, thank you for everything that you're doing, everything you've done, everything you're going to do. Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for the very air that we breathe, the very thoughts in our head, and Lord, the fact that you give us the ability to critically think about you, the ability to love you, the ability to come to you, and you don't demand it. Lord, that you will absolutely give us love overflowing and joy indescribable and peace beyond measure. And you want us to flourish, and you want us to be the people you created us to be, and your plans for us are beyond fantastic. And Lord, as you more than provide for all of our needs, we ask that we give a little bit back to you. And as we do so, Lord, we give a little bit back to you, and we do it as an act of worship. And Holy Spirit, I ask that you make us people that are just joyful to give back to you and just to say thank you so much, Lord, for everything. Things that we can't even begin to understand. Lord, once again, we thank you, we love you, and we praise you. In the name of Jesus, we pray, amen. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me. But names will never hurt me. Sticks and stones will break my bones, but names will never hurt me. Who's been told that lie? Yeah, we all have, haven't we? Absolutely. Every one of us, if we haven't been told the lie, we've heard the lie. names, words will absolutely cause you pain. Words can hurt you. Words are important. Words are powerful. Whether we want to believe it or not, words are powerful. Now, when I'm going through the sermon, I'm thinking about the sermon, and I had a talk with my wife, and she works at the school system. And the school system is teaching Leader in Me. Leader in Me is based upon the seven Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. Ever heard that book before? Yeah. Deb's like, yeah, I've heard about this book before. And what's habit number one? Be proactive. Be proactive. That's habit number one. Be proactive. And so when we talk about being proactive, there's a thing called proactive speech, that they're teaching the children to speak and the teachers to speak proactively. Now, I'm going to go and I'm going to read a little bit from an article on LinkedIn from our buddy Ali Hassaf. Now, just listen to this. Are you ready to unlock the true potential and achieve your life's purpose? Be proactive. Propel yourself forward. Overcome any obstacle in your way. Guess what? It all starts with using proactive language. But why does proactive language matter? Words hold incredible power. They shape our thoughts and actions. Be consciously choosing positive words. By consciously choosing positive words, we nurture a positive mental environment, making it easier to manifest our goals. Language reflects our level of proactivity. Reactive language leads us to avoid responsibility, while proactive language empowers us to take charge of our lives. So instead of saying, there's nothing I can do, let's explore alternatives and choose a different approach. Embrace your freedom to make choices. Embrace your freedom to make choices. So Ali here says what? Words hold incredible power. They shape our thoughts and our actions. Now, those of you who know me know I get to go to work every Monday. And Sheila used to go to work every Monday as well, but she no longer does because she's retired. And so when you get to go to work in the morning, you're making your coffee and people are coming around, people are walking into the office, and one of the things they like to ask you is, how you doing? And what's your typical answer? Fine. I'm fine. I'm good. What is fine? What is good? That's like the neutral answer, right? I'm good. I'm fine. Now, when they walk around the corner and say, how you doing today? I go, I'm fantastic. What is wrong with this guy? I'm out of here. But people stop and they're like, really? Why? It's a great day to be alive. I get to come to work today. I get to be here. I have a job and it's really a fantastic job. Even though I hated working there, didn't like working there. And there were so many things that were wrong. But I could go through the litany of all the negative reasons of why I was there. And thank God I'm no longer there. But what do I do instead? Focus on the positive. Stay positive. Even by me sitting there and saying, I am fantastic, it sets my day up to be different and not think about the negative. I'm going to go in, do the best that I can do today for this company. I'm going to give them the abilities that I have to let them be successful. Wasn't about the job or the culture. We can change the very way we think by what we say. So now the next time someone asks you the question, how are you doing today? How are you going to answer them?
Awesome.
Perfect. Awesome. Fantastic. No, you laugh, but that's what we ought to be doing. I'm fantastic. I'm great. It's the best day ever, right? I love walking into Dr. White's office Monday morning, and he'll ask me the question, how are you doing today? Oh, it's the best day ever. He laughs, you know, because it's the way I say it, but it's a little joke that we have going on. He's like, hey, this guy's always upbeat. Every staff member's upbeat. When you go in there, you feel good to be in there. Why? the words they use and how they speak to you. So if you think you can change the way you think by what you say, imagine what you can do for others by what you say. Your words are incredibly powerful, and they shape our thoughts and our actions. Now today, we're going to look at so many Bible verses today, don't even attempt to keep up to these. All right? I just want you to know, put your Bibles down. Don't try and turn the pages, because I'm going to go like, I want you to know that, all right? The very first thing I'm going to do to show you that words are powerful, though, is I'm going to go to Genesis. In Genesis 3, God says, what? In Genesis 3, then God said, let there be light. Power in words? You think there's power in words? God said, then God said, then God said, verses 6, verses 9, verses 14, verses 20, verse 24, verse 26, and God said, let's make man in our own image. God said, the power of words. God said. God didn't think it. God said it, and it was so. The power of words. All starts right from the very beginning in Genesis. They hold incredible power. There's also warnings in Scripture about using our tongue, about what we say. One of the most famous ones is probably James 3. James 3, verses 3 through 10. James 3, verses 3 through 10. We can make a large horse go wherever we want by means of a small bit in its mouth. And a small rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. Little tiny things move a horse. Little tiny things move a big old ship. In the same way, the tongue is a small thing that makes grand speeches. But a tiny spark can set a great forest on fire. And among all the parts of the body, the tongue is a flame of fire. It is the whole world of wickedness corrupting your entire body. It can set your whole life on fire. For it is set on fire by hell itself. People can tame all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and fish. But no one can tame the tongue. It is a restless and evil, full of deadly poison. Sometimes it praises our Lord, our Father, and sometimes it curses those who has been made in the image of God. And so blessings and cursings come pouring out of the same mouth. Surely, my brothers and sisters, this is not right. This is not right. You want some water? Okay, I'll get some water for you if you want some water. Okay, sorry. But I want her to feel better. I'm asking that because I want her to feel better. You know, I don't want to. But so surely, my brothers and sisters, this is not right. It's not right. Blessings and curses. Who blesses God and curses God out of their same mouth? Pretty much every single person in here. Pretty much every single person in here curses people and then turn around and blesses God. Pretty hopeless. No, actually, it's actually kind of hopeful. Because when I do lose control of my tongue, there's grace beyond grace beyond grace. God gives me so much grace. He's not going to condemn me when I lose control of my tongue because he knows I'm going to do it. He doesn't want me to, but when I do it, I don't have to beat myself over it. I have to continually remember that my words are incredibly powerful. Incredibly powerful. So much so, Jesus says in Matthew 15:11, it's not what goes into your mouth that defiles you, but what comes out of it. Think about that. I'm not defiled by what I do, I'm defiled by what I say. What? Hold on. I'm not defiled by what I do so much as by what I say. Your words hold so much power. Your words hold so much power. And you can be defiled just by saying something. So many words. Now we're going to go through so many scriptures that talk about words. Just keep going on. The power of words themselves. Jesus says again in Matthew 12:36-37, I tell you this, you must give an account on judgment day for every idle word you speak. must give an account on Judgment Day for every idle word you speak. The words you say will either acquit you or condemn you. Standing before God, the words you speak will either acquit you or condemn you. Ephesians 4:29. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say, be good and helpful, so your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. Let some of the things you say be good and helpful. Everything you say, be good and helpful. Why? To encourage all of those around us. Do we say good and helpful words only to Christians? No, we say good and helpful words to everybody. Encourage everybody. The tongue can bring life or death. Those who love to talk will reap the consequences. Proverbs 18:21. Proverbs 21:23. Watch your tongue, keep your mouth shut, and you will stay out of trouble. Those of you that know my father-in-law, he was a police officer in Pontiac for 25 years or something like that. And he loved to tell some stories. And there was one guy that they were 99.9999% sure he was guilty. But they got off every single time because he never said a word. Think about that for a second. Right? Stay out of trouble. Keep your mouth shut. I know it's a bad way to say it, but just, you don't need to talk. People accuse you of something, Ed, whether you did it or not. What do you do? What do you do? Keep your mouth shut. You would baffle them with your wisdom. No, you don't need to defend yourself with your words. You don't need to defend yourself with your words. Proverbs 15:1. A gentle answer deflects anger, but harsh words makes tempers flare. You're falsely accused, my friend. What does a gentle answer do? Turns away anger. Fuses, deflects. Harsh words, on the other hand, makes tempers flare. I think we've all been in that particular situation, haven't we? Proverbs 15:4. Gentle words are a tree of life. Gentle words are a tree of life. A deceitful tongue crushes the spirit. Crushes the spirit. Deceitful tongue. Again, words, right? Our words hold incredible power. They shape the very thoughts and actions of what we do. Proverbs 12:18. Some people make cutting remarks, but the words of the wise bring healing. Proverbs 11:9. With their words, the godless destroy their friends, but knowledge will rescue the righteous. Proverbs 16:24. Kind words are like honey, sweet to the soul and healthy for the body. Kind words are like honey, sweet to the soul and healthy for the body. Proverbs 18:20. Wise words satisfy like a good meal. The right words bring satisfaction. Proverbs 20:15. Wise words are more valuable than much gold and many rubies. Wise words are more valuable than much gold and many rubies. Proverbs 25:18. Telling lies about others is as harmful as hitting them with an axe, wounding them with a sword, or shooting them with a sharp arrow. Think about that. Think about what happens when you tell lies about others, when you slander them. Think about how you can destroy somebody's life by the words that come out of your mouth, whether they're true or not. First Peter 3:10. For the scriptures say, if you want to enjoy life, if you want to, and who wants to enjoy life? Anybody want to enjoy life around here? Anybody online want to enjoy life? I want to enjoy life. You don't want to? I still do. And Peter tells me, for the scriptures say, if you want to enjoy life and see many happy days, keep your tongue from speaking evil and your lips from telling lies. From speaking evil and your lips from telling lies. Okay. Those were a couple verses. Who counted them? How many did I read? A lot, right? I read a lot. Now you're trying to ask me, why did I read so many? Come on, I know you're asking this question, and I'm glad you asked the question. I knew you would ask that question. See, I knew it. You know why I read so many? Words hold incredible power. They shape our thoughts and actions. And even Scripture agrees with that statement. The statement I read from Ollie, it's not a Christian article. It's on LinkedIn. You can find it. The world itself knows that words hold incredible power and they shape our very thoughts and actions. And it lines up with Scripture. Not just once or twice or three times, but many times. I even took some out of here. Over and over and over and over again. It's a constant theme. Watch what you're saying, Deb. Every interaction, Deb, can bring life or death. Every interaction, I can lift Deb up or tear her down. I have that choice. To make that choice before the very words come out of my mouth. I don't have to speak before I think. I can actually take time and think before I speak. There's a split second from this to this. If your first response is something negative, shut up. Step back. And don't say something negative. Is that even possible? It is possible. Absolutely. For sure it's possible. It's absolutely possible. Now another article, Harnessing the Power of the Tongue by Michael Hyatt. Harnessing the Power of the Tongue. I'm only going to read bits and pieces of his article. And he starts his article out this way. Our words carry enormous weight. Our words carry enormous weight. More than we sometimes think. They often impact people, get this, for decades. For decades. Providing either courage to press on or one more reason to give up. Very true. Very true. We have an epidemic, not just in this town, but throughout the world. People taking their own lives. The very words that we say to them. You can either pour life into somebody, or you can destroy them. Think about the latest one we had in town. Would it have made a difference if we had poured life into this kid? Very words that we speak? I think so. We have to watch what we say. You could destroy someone for decades. Who remembers things that they were told them in high school that still cause pain? All right? And we're not, I'm sorry, folks, but we're not just freshly out of high school. We've been out of high school for 1 or 2 years. 3. Bruce has been out for 3. But we can hurt people. We can hurt people for decades. For decades. He goes on to say, I think that's why Ephesians 4:29 is one of my favorite Bible verses. Ephesians 4:29 reads, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, for only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. He writes, I try to live by this wisdom every day, to make yourself a more positive influence using your words, right? To make yourself a more positive influence using your words. Remember these three characteristics to wholesome speech. The three characteristics that he talks about for wholesome speech. Wholesome words build people up. Wholesome words build people up. Now again, every word that comes out of your mouth, you're going to build someone up or you're going to tear them down. Wholesome talk or unwholesome talk? Your choice. Words are very powerful, extremely powerful. Number two, wholesome words are timely. You may have something you think is a wholesome word, but you may not be the right time to say it. Think about when people are hurting, and you don't have anything to say. Even if you think you have something good to say. There's a certain amount of discernment to being able to say nothing. Just as there's a certain amount of discernment to being able to say the right thing at the right time. Wholesome words provide a benefit. Number three, wholesome words provide a benefit. The things we say do something active in the lives of others. My words can activate something within you. Our words can either empower people and make them want to press on, or diminish them and make them want to quit. Every interaction that you have with people, every single day, you have the empowerment to make them want to press on, or diminish them and make them want to quit. Words hold incredible power. They shape our thoughts and actions. Words hold incredible power. They can shape the thoughts and actions of others as well. I don't just have to be positive for myself. I have to be positive for everyone else around me and to them, to lift them up, to get them to think differently. When someone says, how was your day? And they say, man, my day is crap. Where do you go from there? Oh, that's great. I'm out of here. At that point, there's different words to say. You don't run into people very often that are that honest. We'll say that when they're having a bad day. But when you do, there's words to say that you can pour life into them. You pour life into them. When two guys get together and they start complaining about their wives, never happens. Doesn't really happen. It does sometimes. You know what usually happens, Deb? He'll complain about his wife, I'll complain about my wife. And his next story is better than mine. My next story, it like builds. Not that that ever really happens. It's a fictitious story. But it does happen. And that's right. But it is a choice that we make, though. Right, to continue on down that road, and to be a part of that conversation. To let your words bring life or death. Yeah. Your marriage. And I know women will never complain about their husbands. That would never happen either. It goes both ways. Right? But even when we're talking to other people about our spouses, if we continue on the road of negativity, you walk away from that conversation thinking, man, my wife really is horrible. And the truth of the matter is my wife is fantastic, but I've just been so, absent-minded that I let these unwholesome words continue out of my mouth, forgetting that my words are extremely powerful. They just change the way I think. Absolutely change the way I think. instead of having a positive uplifting, I love my wife, I now have, man, my wife got this, there's this wrong with her. This is really? Every interaction, even if I'm not the interaction of talking to Deb and tearing Deb down, if I'm talking bad about Tina and tearing Tina down, it's changing the way you think about Tina. Whether I want it to or not. About me too. Words are powerful. They shape our very thoughts and our actions. We have to be careful with every word that comes out of our mouth. Every single interaction, we have to be careful. Think about that. Think about that. By changing how we speak, we can change the very way we think. Let me say it again. By changing how we speak, we can change the very way we think. Proverbs 18:21. The tongue can bring life or death. Those who love to talk will reap the consequences. Are consequences always bad? No, consequences are just the effect, right? So those that love to talk a lot, we know one or two people in here that love to talk a lot. If I'm always speaking life, consequences of my life then are life. Yeah, positive. If I'm always speaking death, what are the consequences of that? Yeah, negative, right? So the fact is, how I'm speaking is literally changing the way I'm thinking. Words hold incredible power. They shape our thoughts and our actions. We should think before we speak. We should understand that literally everything that comes out of our mouth, literally every word that we say, can bring life or death. Can bring life or death. Who here speaks more death than they do life? You want to change that, don't you? How do we change it? Shut up. That is one way. You pray. You pray. Right? And understanding that you speak more negative than you do positive. And understanding that the words that I say are huge, that they can change the very outcome of my life and the very way I think and the very way I act. And knowing that, I hope you want to change it. You can't do it alone. You do it with the host of everybody else. Right? We will come around you. We will pray for you. Pray with you. And get with that. Get with me. And admitting it. And that's huge. Right? To say, yeah, you know, there are times I'm more negative than positive. I know when I do it, and I know I shouldn't do it. And my day just continues to get worse. I started the day on the wrong foot. The whole day just shot. I know better. But I do it anyways. Yeah, so we're all guilty. It's a decision, and sometimes we don't make the right decision. Right. Sometimes we wake up, we don't make, but we still, literally, days, Deb, there are days I'm up in the morning, I'm like step after step going, it's a horrible day. My mind, again, I can either speak that, or I can say, okay, Lord, I know you don't want this. I'm going to speak positively. And literally change it very way. So no matter what I feel, no matter how I am this particular day, when somebody asks me, my answer is going to be, I'm fantastic. And just imagine what the church looks like when every single one of us are pouring life into people, what we say. Let's be like David when he says, take control of what I say, O Lord, and guard my lips. Father, we thank you for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. And Holy Spirit, help us to change the very words that come out of our mouths. So that the words that come out of our mouth that are powerful, all our words are powerful, Lord, that we are pouring life into people. We're pouring life not just into our lives by the words we speak, but we're pouring life into the love of all those around us. That our words can change the very way we think, Lord, and let good, wholesome, life-giving words just flow out of our mouths. Lord, help us change our mindsets to be more tuned in to the love, the joy, and the peace that we have available to us. Lord, help us be more tuned in to encouraging those around us by the very things that we say, that we praise you with our lips. We don't curse those around us with them. We can only do that. Number one, recognize it. Number two, realize we can't do it alone and we need your help. We need the help of the church around us. Lord, we thank you that you want us to have an abundant, flourishing, awesome life. Help us go in the direction by the words that we speak. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. Words hold incredible power. They shape our very thoughts and actions. So what are you saying?